South Korea, the United States, and Japan reportedly set to hold a joint aerial exercise near the Korean Peninsula for the first time. The drill, set to be happening this Sunday, will involve U.S. B-52 strategic bombers as well as fighter jets of the three countries. The reported drills would be the latest in a series of moves to strengthen ties at a time of growing tensions with North Korea and China's influence in the region. Another failed attempt for outspoken conservative Jim Jordan in securing the top job in the U.S. House of Representatives. Jordan lost a second vote with even less support from his fellow Republicans. Jordan had 199 votes Wednesday, less than the 200 he secured Tuesday. He needs 217 votes to claim the post. The House is now on its 16th day without a leader, leaving Congress unable to respond to the wars in the Middle East and Ukraine or take action to head off another threat of a government shutdown. It's not yet clear if Jordan would mount a third attempt for the speakership. Turning now to the aftermath of the deadly Gaza hospital blast, U.S. President Joe Biden appearing to side with Israel, saying early intelligence indicates this explosion was caused by a Palestinian armed group.
This is what remains of the parking lot of the Ahli Arab Hospital in Gaza City, where a massive blast on Tuesday killed hundreds of people. Arriving in Tel Aviv Wednesday to show support for Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, President Joe Biden said he was deeply saddened and outraged by the hospital explosion.
Based on the information we've seen to date, it appears the result of an errant rocket fired by a terrorist group in Gaza.
Biden said Israel has agreed that humanitarian assistance can begin to move from Egypt to Gaza and announced $100 million U.S. aid for Palestinians. He vowed to provide Israel what it needs to defend itself, but urged restraint in its retaliation.
You live by the rule of law. When conflicts flare, you live by the law of wars.
Netanyahu thanked Biden for his support. His government has pounded Gaza with airstrikes, killing 3,000 people, and ordered 2 million Gazans to evacuate ahead of an expected ground invasion in response to the militant group Hamas' brazen incursion on October 7th, which killed 1,400 people.
Hamas is responsible and should be held accountable for all civilian casualties.
Hamas blamed the hospital blast on an Israeli airstrike, while Israel said it was an errant rocket from the militant group Islamic Jihad. That group also denied responsibility. The hospital was considered a haven for Gazans fleeing Israeli attacks.
I don't know. A missile fell on us. We were on the floor. Everything got destroyed. We were destroyed.
The explosion and Israeli retaliation to Hamas have ignited massive protests in various cities, including in Lebanon, Jordan, Iran, Iraq, Tunisia, and Turkey. Demonstrators laid the blame on Israel. In Tel Aviv, Biden met with Israeli survivors of the October 7th Hamas attack. He had been scheduled to head next to Amman to meet leaders of Jordan, Egypt, and the Palestinian Authority. But the summit and the Jordan leg of the trip were scrapped following the blast. Patsy Widakuswara, VOA News.
The International Criminal Court urged to take action on Palestinian killings. Hundreds of pro-Palestine demonstrators marched to the ICC headquarters in the Netherlands in the aftermath of the deadly hospital blast in Gaza. Protesters blamed Israel for the attack, urging it to stop what they called a genocide.
We do believe in the international law, and here we are in the Netherlands, and this is the building of the International Criminal Court, where we come to ask for all the war criminals, and I believe that Netanyahu is committing war crimes and genocides against the Palestinians and against the innocents, and that's the reason why we came here to protest, and we take this opportunity so the world can see and hear the voice of the innocents and the victims.
Similar protests erupt across the world, including in Yemen, Tunisia, Egypt, West Bank, and the UK. The protesters are calling for a free Palestine and an end to the attacks on the besieged enclave. Defense ministers of the US and the UK discuss asset deployment to the Middle East. During a meeting at the Pentagon, US Defense Chief Lloyd Austin and his British counterpart Grant Shapps agreed deploying more assets in Israel will prevent further destabilization in the region.
U.S. security assistance to Israel continues to flow in at the speed of war. We've also directed the USS Dwight D. Eisenhower carrier strike group to the eastern Mediterranean, where it will join the USS Gerald R. Ford and its own strike group. And those changes to our force posture send a clear signal to deter hostile actors from trying to shed more blood or to escalate this war.
And we've seen the barbaric acts of Hamas Saturday, a week ago. They hate our way of life. And we stand together as nations who are prepared to put our money where our mouth is and send assets to the region.
Muslim and Jewish communities in the U.S. are on alert. This after a six-year-old Palestinian boy was stabbed to death in an attack believed to be linked to the Israel-Hamas conflict.
Since the start of the Israel-Hamas war, Muslim and Jewish communities in the U.S. have been on high alert, fearing being the target of hostilities. One of the most recent victims of an alleged hate crime was a six-year-old Muslim boy who was found stabbed to death in Illinois on Saturday. President Joe Biden strongly condemned the killing of the child and instructed his government to prioritize the prevention and disruption of any emerging threats. Fadwa Hassan was born in the U.S. and has Palestinian relatives in the West Bank. She's concerned not only about them, but also about increasing tensions at home.
Any woman who wears a hijab or even when you come to our institution to pray, we have to worry now about, we've always had to worry about violence.
Linda Shapiro says that fear and anxiety are rising among members of her Jewish community and that her synagogue in Northern Virginia has tightened security measures.
We shouldn't be engaging in blame or hateful speech. We have to keep reminding ourselves and everyone else that this is all on Hamas.
The latest FBI statistics show that anti-Jewish hate crimes in the U.S. have surged in recent years, increasing by 36% last year alone. Anti-Muslim incidents have remained largely steady, fewer than 200 a year. But analysts warn that numbers usually go up when foreign conflicts erupt.
One of the things that we know from past events is that when we have American casualties related to some kind of foreign conflict, or if we have conflicts between Israelis and Palestinians, both anti-Muslim hate crimes go up significantly and anti-Jewish hate crimes go up significantly.
The Council on American-Islamic Relations, or CAIR, told VOA that since the start of the war, it has been overwhelmed with concerns from individuals who've been targeted. But beyond condemning the violence, the root causes of the Middle East conflict should be addressed by the concerned parties, said CAIR's research and advocacy director, Corey Saylor.
For decades, we have been talking about dialogue. We have been advancing the idea that negotiations will get us to a peaceful settlement.
Meanwhile, the Anti-Defamation League, a U.S.-based Jewish anti-hate organization, pointed out that the Jewish community in the U.S. isn't a monolith and that ongoing acts of harassment against it aren't warranted.
These conflicts that are happening abroad are sometimes very raw and emotional for communities here. But we have to understand that the actions of a government, a war that is happening overseas, should not be put onto an entire religious or an entire ethnic community.
When hate crimes or violent incidents do happen, authorities encourage victims to promptly report them to their local police stations or non-governmental organizations. Veronica Valderas Iglesias, VOA News, Alexandria, Virginia.